sure it's here to blossom. And again, I'd like to thank everyone for the sale that helped. Saturday, we've got a sign up the angle at the Redwood Bowling Alley that was purchased for us, and we've got to go up and take that thing down Saturday. Rex Rowles is going to help us. We're going to take a forklift and we're going to cut the signs loose and slide them out on the forks and let them down. And then we've got an air conditioner unit to pull off the wall yet. So we're going to do that Saturday morning, and it won't take us long. We'll get back here and get about our business for the rest of the day. I have got a dear friend here this morning that has really influenced my life. And part of his, well, all of his teaching, I've tried to be a part of, be attentive to, and listen to what he has to say. He's known as the Church Doctor Ministries over in Corona. And you're thinking, Corona? But this man goes all over the world and helps churches that plateau, helps the committees that are fighting amongst themselves, and the elders and the pastors, and God only knows what this man deals with. Come on up, Ken. Ken Hines. I've been through two church counselings with him, and I paid attention and learned. And it's the basis that we have planted Destiny Family Faith on. His stuff works if you do it. It's like anything else. If you want something to work, you got to do something. And this man is so blessed, and we're so honored to have him be a part of this church. He's the founder of SEND. We know Josh Homburg and the SEND students that are here. We're so blessed to house them and have that be a part of our ministry. Kent is on a mission, and I'm going to let him explain it. I want us to partner with him in this. I want you to open your spiritual ears and listen to what Kent has to say. They're passing out some flyers right now that I'm sure will go into more depth than Kent's going to be able to get into today. But I want you to open your hearts and your spiritual ears to what Ken has to say this morning and listen to how God would lead you into supporting this mission that Ken's on. Ken, God bless. Love you.
Love you too. Hey, you know why I get up in the morning?
Why?
Every morning God's called me. I get up in the morning to see God's kingdom grow. Mm-hmm. And every once in a while, you know, I get to come here and visit you guys. And every time I come, I see more and more people hearing about Jesus and coming to Christ, having their needs met through the Lord's power. I noticed this morning there are more people on the worship team than the first time I came here.
That's right.
All together.
That's the truth.
And so I just praise God for what He's doing here. I really mean that. This really makes my day. So I have been blessed before you even start the message.
Thank you.
I just really thank you. I've been invited to go to Belize in Central America. This is not the first time I've been invited. I've been dozens of times around the world, Africa, Asia, South America, all over the world, to train pastors. They've gathered together. Some of the key leaders in Belize in Central America, and they've asked us to come in July and share with them about discipling, multiplying, and making disciples. And so there's a mission agency that's put this whole thing together, asked me to come and speak. And what they've done is they've asked me also to provide each of these pastors with a copy of a book that I wrote years ago called Foundations for Church Growth. And each of these pastors, they read English, they speak English in Belize, and so they want to give them this in follow-up and follow-through so they can repeat what I teach to them back in their churches with other people. They want to start a movement with the gospel across Belize in Central America. So they asked me to get one of these books for each one of the pastors. You might think, well, I wrote the book. I own the book. I don't own the book. That's one thing. If you've never written a book, you don't know. you don't own your own book. Your name's on the front, but the publisher owns the book. So I can't give these away free because I don't own them. They belong to the publisher. And so we're asking people for a special opportunity to really bless them, to bless people, to bless a pastor you will never meet this side of eternity, but you will meet them someday as a believer. These are people that I've never met, people you won't meet in this lifetime, but to just bless them with a resource that will go on for months and months and years as they multiply this experience. And so they passed out a little brochure here today, and we'd like you to partner with one of those pastors. You're not partnering with me, you're joining me on the team, really. You're part of this team going to Central America by partnering with one or more of these pastors. Now, most important, I love this ministry at Destiny. I love this ministry, you know that. And so we're not trying to take away anything you do to support this ministry. We support this ministry. We pray for Destiny. And so this is not about that. This is if the Lord touches your heart to sponsor one or more pastors, we would love you to do that. And I really want to encourage you to fill out the sheet that's inside with your support, because we want to give you a report. If you give us your address or your email or whatever, when I come back in later July, I want to send you a personal report about what happened there, things that I don't even know at this point. But I know God's going to bless this. He always does. It's His work. And so we're going to give glory to Him, but we want to share with you what really happened at this conference in Belize. And so if you partner with us, we also want to thank you. But as we thank you, we're going to also be accountable and report to you about what happened. So be sure to put your name and address there also so that we can send you that report. And to God be the glory, and let's see the Great Commission move throughout Belize, huh? Yeah.
Terry's put a box back there, and if you feel led to bless this ministry, it's like Kent said, there's a tithe and then there's an offering. So the offering is over and above, and that's what we're going to bless this ministry with. You've all been taught how to do that, so you know. So I'm going to pray over Kent right now and ask the Holy Spirit to lead and guide you in what you do, and we're going to bless him. Can you imagine being a pastor in a foreign country and craving to know Jesus, craving to know more about Jesus so you could not have it for yourself but for the sheep that you've been entrusted to? You all reap what you sow. So this is going to be a cool opportunity to receive a blessing. Father, we thank you for Kent. We thank you for his heart to teach and give away the knowledge and wisdom that you've blessed him with. And Lord, there's an opportunity here to bless pastors. How can they know unless they preach? How can they hear unless we are sent to preach? Kent is being sent to teach those that are called to preach. So we ask, Lord, that you would honor this desire to have finances to furnish these books to pastors. Lord, open the hearts and the minds of us that know what it is to serve and do missions across the country and across the United States and the world. So Lord, we commit this into your will and care. We know you have exact amount finances that are going to furnish the training and the knowledge and wisdom that Ken has to offer. So we give you ahead of time all the praise, the glory, and the honor for supplying the need, the desires of church doctrine ministry's heart. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, brother.
You know how much I like to invest in pastors? This one's yours, on me. God bless you. Yeah. God bless Destiny. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. You know, we're at a place right now that we may have to really call upon his name. I got to share a quick story. I called Kent and I asked him if I could meet with him. And it was early on as we were ready to church plant. And Kent, I shouldn't tell this on him, but I'm going to anyhow. He thought, yeah, right. You want to take me to breakfast. All you want is some free information on how to do it. and I offered to open the place up for Slim to be the training center for this new vision he had. Blew you away, did it? But you know what? That is payment back for what was paid to us. That's reaping and sowing. And Kent is such a blessing. And we're to the place, we're at a plateau right now of 200 people, and that's a stalling point. So we're gonna have him probably talk to us and lead and guide us here down the future and where we need to go to get things going on a little higher level. And a little later, we're gonna do some things to get that going yet today. But I want you, if the Lord's leading you to do that, to put a special offering, mark your envelope on the chairs and drop it back in the box there. And then the church is gonna bless them too, as the body. Well, again, I'd like to welcome everybody. We're at a bittersweet, for me anyhow, place this morning. We're the last section of the last chapter in John. I wish I would have written down the day we started. Oh my gosh, it was eons ago. I think over a year and a half ago we started in John. Verse by verse, word by word, we have studied the book of John. John, the one whom Jesus loved, records the life of Jesus in John. And I love it because I told you before, it's so simple. It's for baby Christians. It's for old Christians to renew and recommit their life to Jesus. The Savior was sent for you and me. What an awesome message in the book of John. Some of us here this morning have been through a lot. Can you agree with me? Every one of us. Some of us here this morning have lost a loved one, have been through divorce. With this many people in here, somebody in here has been sexually abused. You've had absent parents in your life. You've committed adultery. You've fallen short of the glory of God. The scripture says every one of us has fallen short of the glory of God. That means we needed the Savior that died on the cross for us. We all have had a need for restoration. Every one of us. And if you haven't yet, oh my God, hang on to your socks because you're going to need it. The book of John ends with restoration. And it's about Peter, one of the coolest people in Scripture. I like to kind of sort of hope I'm like Peter. Do stupid stuff and have Jesus turn it to good. You're better off to do something stupid than to sit on your lazy butt and do nothing. Pardon the French if that offends you. Peter, a disciple. I'd like to read Matthew 16 in verses 13 through 18. I want to establish who Peter is. Patrick's got her up there. I'm behind that. 16, verse 13. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say the Son of Man is?" I want to ask you, who do you say the Son of Man is? If somebody asked you, who is Jesus, who's the Son of Man, could you answer that question, or you would stammer and stutter and act goofy? It is so important that you have a relationship so deep with Jesus that you won't hesitate. You can instantly tell somebody that needs to know who Jesus is. Scripture says to be prepared to give and share the hope you have in Christ Jesus. They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And then Jesus says, but what about you, he asked, who do you say I am? And I thought it's cool, he presents that question to all the disciples. Who answers the question? Peter. Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. Valuable lesson there. Don't listen to what man's got to say, unless he's righteous, spiritual, and upright, because he will guide you wrong every time. The Father is the one. The Father in heaven is the one we need to be listening to. Okay? And I tell you that you are Peter. He calls him Simon in the beginning, and he's going to give him a command. He's going to give him a blessing in a second. And he gives him a new name before he does it. He changes his name from Simon, you are Peter. And on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome. Our songs this morning, I thought it was so cool. The worship team picks out songs about overcoming. And here it's in our scripture this morning. Every good building, every good thing has a solid rock foundation, or it will crumble and die. God has just given Peter the command that you are the rock that I'm going to build the church upon. And he's not talking about a building. He's talking about you and me. You think this building that we're setting in is a church? It's all of us. I said so many times, when I unlock that door on Sunday morning and the lights are out, it's an empty building with the lights out. And the second I walk in here, it gets a little brighter because I brought Jesus in. And everyone that shows up after that, it gets brighter and brighter, and the glow of Jesus is all over this place. And the gates of hell will not overcome. There are some of us in here that are stuck in prophecy. We're listening to Fox News. We're getting jacked out of shape about Obama and all the baloney that's going on. Oh my God, what are we going to do for insurance? Ain't about that, guys and gals. It's about the church. It's about being a rock. It's about being focused on what Jesus has called you and me to. That other stuff is going to go on until hell freezes over. So focus on your neighbor, focus on the one that you work with, focus on your family member that needs Jesus. Because if he has Jesus in his life, no matter what happens to him or her, they've got the glory in heaven forever and ever. Focus on what's important. Peter, the disciple that full well knows who Jesus is, and then life gets in the way. We're forced to make decisions. Are we not forced to make decisions every day? Every day we wake up, we're forced to make decisions. Decisions that we don't want to have to make, but we're forced to make them. Can we do the right thing? That's what I'm asking you this morning. Can we do the right thing? We have to do the right thing, because anything else is wrong. Peter, in the 18th chapter of John, denies Jesus three times. Not once, but three times. How many of you have been slapped in the face by a good friend or somebody you work with or somewhere about something? Didn't it hurt? Can you imagine turning the cheek and having him slap the other side? And then can you imagine turning your cheek back and having him slap the other side again? Three times. It's bad enough for somebody we love, somebody we respect, to hurt us, but for them to do it three times? I'm telling you, that's about as low as it gets. It hurts deep. It cuts to the core of our heart. Three times plays out in the end of John. We've heard the number three so many times in the end. And I said last week, it stands for completion. John is finishing up the book of John with completion. Everything Jesus did complete what he was sent to do. There's nothing left undone. You and I can't do anything else to do what needed to be done to reconnect us to God the Father. Jesus paid the full price. And Jesus appears to the disciples three times. The earth was dark for 3 hours. And Jesus completely pays for our salvation the third day. He raises. He's alive. He paid for Peter's restoration, reinstallation into the kingdom. All Jesus could do to Peter was talk to him and say, Peter, you're going to deny me. He hadn't paid the price yet, but now he's meeting with Peter and he's paid the full price. He can restore him into the kingdom. He has to restore Peter before he returns to the Father. The rock he builds the church on. You and I have callings that it's almost impossible to do without Christ.
Right.
I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. And if we don't have Christ, it's hard to do it. He's the rock that Christ is going to build the church on. And he's going to show and tell Peter, if there's no forgiveness, there's no building up. And for some of us in here, that's a valuable word, because you're holding bitterness and unforgiveness in your heart, and it's hindering you from building up the church, the body of Christ. And you've got to lay it at his feet. He paid the price. This Peter has walked on the water. He cuts a guy's ear off as Jesus is going to the cross, and Jesus has got to take time out and heal it. He's always doing something, whether it's right or wrong, and I admire him for that. He falls asleep when Jesus needs his best friends at his side for an hour. All he says is, guys, can't you watch and pray for an hour? And Peter's with the crew. He falls asleep when Jesus needs his friends the most. And then he denies the Lord, not once, but three times. He slaps Jesus in the face, spits in his face, denies him three times. That hurt Jesus. Can you imagine walking the earth for 30 years and then doing ministry for three, sowing into 12 guys' lives so deeply and praying for them and having them slap you in the face three times? I can only imagine. Denying the Lord causes separation. I want us to think about that. When we ask him or talk to him and we don't see a delivered prayer right away, don't deny him, don't slap him in the face. Be still and know that he's God. Let him deliver to you what he wants to deliver. Denying the Lord causes separation, and it's separation from the kingdom work. He's given every one of you and me spiritual gifts. And if we deny the Lord, then our spiritual gift is missing, and there's a part of the body of Christ that's short. Jesus restores Peter. Let's read our text this morning. It's in John 21, the last section of John 21. The last of John. We're going to start in 15. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me? He's used truly here two different times. I want us to pay attention to that. Truly doing something comes from every inner part of your being. It's your mind, your will, and your emotions. He's saying, Peter, do you truly love me? is your mind and your will and your emotions really, really in tune with me? And if Peter really got the concept of that, he's thinking, wow, I've let you down so many times, Lord. I wanted to do what's right, but I didn't. Do you truly love me, Peter? He answered, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He left the truly out there. He's talking about a different kind of love here. We call it agape love, fatherly love. Guys, we love our wives. Wives, we love our husbands. Church, body of Christ, we love God the Father first, more than anything. And he's saying, Peter, do you love me? Two different kinds of love here. One from the mind, will, and emotions, the other one from the heart. We've got to love Jesus, God the Father, the Holy Spirit, completely from our heart. Because our mind, our will, and our emotions will cause us to do stupid things. It will cause us to deny the Lord three times. It will cause us to take a group of people with us and lock ourselves in a room and be afraid. It will cause us to return back to our old ways, jump in the boat, and go fishing and catch nothing until Jesus comes and says, boys, cast your net on the other side of the boat. We can do nothing without Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Try it and see how you get along. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? Here's a Peter that's denied the Lord three times. He ought to feel guilty. He ought to feel ashamed. He ought to feel separated. And what does he do? He gets ticked because Jesus asked him, do you love me? Bad move. See, the mind, the will, and emotions got a hold of him and caused his heart to go astray again. We got to be careful with our mind, our will, and our emotions because they will let us down. And we were warned to listen to God rather than man. Man will use his mind, will, and emotions to completely misdirect you. We have to count on God the Father. He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. I tell you the truth. When you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. He's been telling Peter, you know, your mind, will, and emotions has been directing you. You haven't been completely following me. But I'm here to tell you, Peter, when you are old, you'll stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. And Jesus gave him the answer, follow me, Peter. Follow me. Not your mind, your will, and your emotions. Follow me. Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved, and we all know that's John that wrote the book here, the book of John, and then he writes Revelation. Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved was following him. This was the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, Lord, who is going to betray you? So John is kind of got that ball in motion with Peter, introducing what's going to happen. He opened the door for Jesus to answer. When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" Oh my God, here we go. If you're going to treat me really bad and have me get a painful suffering killing, what about the one you love, dude? How you going to treat him? Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me,